Thank you, Yossi. So, and good evening to every one of you. I hope you can understand me because my Hebrew is non-existent, I should say, because I just arrived 3 months ago in the country, so I'm still struggling with it. But it's a pleasure and an honor for me to be here with you tonight, addressing the very distinguished audience, which is convened by ADVAR and its excellent projects about the economic policy of the Netanyahu government in the last 4 years. But since many of you are young, and perhaps the first time here in such an event, let me just briefly introduce to you the Friedrich Ebert Stiftung. We are a German political foundation, by far the oldest one, namely founded already in 1925, a long time ago, as the political legacy of the first social democratic president of the first social of the first German Republic, Friedrich Ebert. And in his last will, he said, basically, don't put any flowers on my grave, but donate money so that people, that we can create a fund, foundation, that's what we are now. People, young people, especially from underprivileged classes, from the working classes, can get access to higher education, which at that time was expensive in Germany. It still is in many countries today as well. I don't know about Israel, I must say. And this is how we started our business, with a small grant from all the people coming to the funeral of Friedrich Ebert. In 1933, we were immediately banned by the Nazis, but luckily, few survivors of the original foundation could reconstitute the Stiftung, this means foundation in German, directly after the Second World War. And then we started again to work in Germany. Then in the 50s, with many countries becoming independent, decolonization process, we became more and more involved in international business as well, international consultancy. And nowadays we have 110 offices around the world. In Israel, our office was opened in 1978 already, but the first activities took place in 1962, even before the official diplomatic relations between Germany and Israel were established. The first contacts to our partners in Israel go back to the late 50s already. And as you can imagine, we are, let's say, a social democratic political foundation close to the Social Democratic Party of Germany and social democratic ideas. Our main partners in Israel were and are the trade unions and the parties from the left, the Labour Party and Meretz, basically. So this as a short background. But let me now come to the substantive issue of this meeting here, which is about the Israeli economy and how is it doing. As you know probably quite well, the Israeli economy is seen as a very successful economy, which not only managed to have high growth rates over a prolonged period of time, but which also was weathering the global financial and economic crisis quite well. Nevertheless, there are some structural challenges which threaten to undermine the success story. First and foremost, from my point of view, it's the high income inequality, which is one of the highest of all OECD countries. In countries that belong to the OECD, inequality increased in recent years even more than in the preceding two decades. So we realize we have in all OECD countries a very high increase of income inequality. And as a result of these processes, income inequality within OECD countries is at a historic high. How can you explain this rise? A number of factors are at play. One is technological change, which in recent decades has conferred an advantage on those who are working with computers and information technology and have the necessary skills to do it. Global supply chains, outsourcing, have moved low-skilled tasks out of advanced economies, and thus the demand for highly skilled workers in advanced economies has increased, raising their incomes relative to those less skilled. These are the traditional factors of explanation, but recent research done by the International Monetary Fund uncovered two other contributors to increased inequality. The first is the opening up of capital markets to foreign entry and competition, which is normally referred to among economists, and I'm one myself, as capital account liberalization. The second source is policy actions by governments to lower the budget deficits. Such actions are referred to as fiscal consolidation, when you talk to IMF economists, or by their critics, as austerity policies. You may have heard that. These results do not imply that countries should not undertake capital account liberalization or fiscal consolidation. But what the latest research suggests is that the benefits out of those policy measures should be weighed against their distributional effects. Distribution is something which economists normally don't look at much. In many cases, governments have the flexibility to design the policy actions in a way that mitigates the distributional impacts. For example, the IMF managing director Christine Lagarde urges a fiscal policy that focuses not only on efficiency, but also on equity, particularly on fairness in sharing the burden of adjustment and on protecting the weak and the vulnerable. Inequality is not only undesirable from a moral and ethical point of view. It is also undesirable from a macroeconomic point of view because it weakens consumer demand. Taking this together with a still ongoing crisis in Europe and the US, where consumer demand is also still weak, it could mean, those two factors together, a major challenge for further growth of the Israeli economy. Therefore, it is very much advisable to focus government policies on combating income and wealth inequality and strengthen domestic demand vis-à-vis foreign demand, meaning exportation. Recent research suggests again that governments should consider actions in their policy designs to mitigate the distributional impacts of fiscal consolidation and liberalization programs and resort, for example, to progressive taxation and the protection of social benefits for vulnerable groups, which can certainly help to counter some of the effects of fiscal consolidation on inequality. This, from my point of view, again, is all the more important since public social expenditure in Israel fell during the last decade at a rate without parallel in the other OECD countries and is well below OECD average. The social movement of 2011 was the first one to seriously raise this challenge, but among the general public, it is still perceived that many of their demands are not yet met. So it still remains unfinished business to make Israel a more equal and just society. And that's why I'm very happy to work together with ADVA on these issues. And I'm especially happy to have Staff Shafir among those who speak to you today. And we are very much looking forward to listen to all of your opinions and remarks. So thank you very much. So, I listened very attentively to the debates and to the questions. And I must admit, I'm not an expert about the Israeli economy, nor Israeli politics. But almost all of the questions which were raised are questions which are not only of concern to the Israeli population and people. They are of concern to people around the world. So Israel in that sense is not an island. It is part of the world. Many people around the world are not happy with the present state of the economy and their society, And that is expressed by the most exciting development in recent decades, which is the emergence of the new social movements around the world. The new social movements have managed to raise issues which before were never raised, nor by experts, nor by politicians, because everyone is caught in traditional paradigms. And the question always was raised also by Steph Shafir, what did social movements achieve? So probably it's not that you can see concrete results in terms of concrete projects. You may see some of them. But what you see, basically, and this is a major breakthrough from my point of view, is, let's say, a different awareness, a different consciousness of people around the world that something is seriously wrong. Something with the present economic system and the political system in many countries is seriously wrong. The economic system, let's call it capitalism, is based on a certain social contract, a promise to people to deliver also some social benefits. But this is not happening anymore. Yeah, the political system, democratic political systems, they also offer a certain contract to the people. Okay, you vote for me and I deliver for you. Also, that is not working anymore. People, and this is again expressed by the new social movements, are not happy with the lack of participation in those systems and in the traditional institutions. So this is the two main factors which I see in many countries having emerged around the world in recent years, triggered by the global economic and financial crisis, which is not over, also triggered by issues which were not discussed here tonight yet, namely sustainability issues. So we are not facing only a world where the present political and economic systems are not working well anymore for the majority of people, but also we face a sustainability crisis, climate change, lack of resources or limited resources. This will also pose new challenges to countries and to governments and to people around the world. And this is something which also should to be considered. So all this comes together now. And there's a lot of demand and desire to change, to have change. It was even expressed by President Obama during his campaign, where he opted for change. But people now say, we don't want change anymore. We want real money. So this is a difference. And the question is, how does real money come about? So from my point of view, the main factor are the people themselves. And it's the empowerment of the people who then decide about their own fate and take part and partial in the political and economic decision making. This is important to achieve. How can people be empowered? This is through education, through modern technologies. So all of you, I assume, I'm pretty sure actually, have a smartphone, a tablet, a computer. So these technologies allow you to have easy access to information anytime during the day. So let's say when you want to learn something about an issue, you can easily do it, you Google it, and you get about it. I mean, I was asking how many tourists are coming to Israel this morning, because tourism is also a very important factor. And my guess was it's about half of the population of Israel, coming in terms, absolute terms, coming as tourists to Israel. So my colleague Judith, she Googled it and she found out, yes, indeed, it's almost 4 million tourists coming to Israel every year, which is a hell of a lot. Yeah, so they are also contributing to the economy. So that's how easy it is. But it also allows, in terms of empowerment, it allows people and politicians to use those technologies in their favor. And that's why I like very much what Steph Shafir said about what she did in the Finance Committee, that she posted help on her Facebook page, and people immediately reacted. And now she has a team of 100 people who help her as a politician to analyze the budget and to to see where the money comes from, where does it go to, yeah, and what are the effects of it. And this is important. Let's say governments around the world, not only the Israeli government, are very often not interested in budget transparency at all. Yeah, they present a budget to the parliamentarians. Parliamentarians are supposed to control the government, of course, sometimes only one day or a few hours before the debate in parliament, and then they want to push it through. And then afterwards, it's very difficult for parliaments and parliamentarians, yeah, to control and monitor what governments are doing with the budget. So this is an excellent way, yeah, which Staff Shafir told us about, yeah, how to change these traditional behaviors and procedures and make people and involve people, yeah, raise participation and thus also raise transparency and thus make governments around the world much more accountable to people than ever before. And I think this is important, and this is a very important factor which will certainly contribute to change, especially now when we all know, and I agree with Tamara, I think is your name, the crisis, the global crisis, is not yet over at all. It's oppressed in a way, yeah, but it's not over. I mean, we have high unemployment still everywhere. Yeah, it's still rising. Today, the Central Bank of Israel published that the unemployment rate rose to 6% or so, I briefly read. Yeah, so, and on the other hand, we have low interest rates, we have relatively low inflation and low growth. So this is a situation which economists describe as depression, because nothing is really happening in the economy, so it's going down the drains more or less. Yeah. Despite low interest rates, investment is not growing. Yeah, the wealthy people, the entrepreneurs who have resources and money, do not invest it. They save it, well, in tax havens or wherever. So this is the greatest danger which I see to the world, namely that we are all in a big slump, yeah, in a big depression, and it will be very difficult to get out of it. So that's why empowerment of people, involvement of every one of you, yeah, with your skills, your knowledge, yeah, in politics and political decision making is essential to really change. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.